Thank you very much, Mr. President, for your very kind word. And I don't know if you notice or not, I'm still blushing. You may not see it, but I am. Ladies and gentlemen, or as with honors reserved, of course, but as we say in Africa, brothers and sisters, good morning. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity to come here and address you. I think this is a very important organization. So thank you for offering me this opportunity. 2015 was a remarkable year because in September in New York, the world leaders adopted the SDGs, and later in December in Paris, the world leaders committed to tackle climate change and made commitments there. This is really refreshing because it's the departure from the norm. Unfortunately, what we have seen over the past few years, that our leaders and our politicians are always shying away from taking crucial long-term decisions. Everybody is kicking the can down the road. And it is very refreshing to be see people standing up and making some commitments. That is wonderful. And what's important now is to watch and see promises turning into actions. And I believe we need to have some sort of a scorecard to really monitor our progress and deliverable, because everybody should be accountable. It's not enough to come and make promises in Paris or in New York. We need deliverables. And I think we need to have that scorecard to keep everybody honest, and that's important. Now, the first and second goals of the SDGs are about ending poverty and hunger, achieving food security, improving nutrition, and promote sustainable agriculture. Goal 15 is about the health of the land and the forests. Now, these three goals more or less really frame the work of this organization, which places you really in the heart of the SDG. And you cannot have a more endorsement than that. You are really in the heart of this very important process of ending poverty and moving our people forward. So that is a very important mission you have here. So how can we get there? Allow me here to focus on Africa. Why Africa? A number of reasons. Because we really have proportionally more hungry, malnutrition people than anywhere else in the world. This is a fact. Reason number two, by far, we are the least productive region in the agricultural sector than anywhere else in the world. That means we have the greatest potential for growth coming from a very long base, a very low base. Third reason, because we have more uncultivated arable lands than anywhere else, than everybody else, which again means we have greater opportunity to increase food production. Reason number four, we actually, by the year 2050, in the next 35 years, we expect to have 2 billion more people on this planet. The majority of these 2 billion people are going to be Africans. This is are the new demographic in 2050. Where the food will come from for those people? And finally, and another reason here, and for the sake of transparency, it's because I'm African, if you have not noticed that. That's why I'm focused on Africa. So let us go to Africa. What's happening in Africa? Agriculture used to be the mainstay of Africa. It used to be the principal economy, and still is, of Africa, where most of our people are involved. 400-500 million Africans are living on and off the land. Very important. What happened, unfortunately, is that we discover a little bit of oil here, some minerals over there, and suddenly we lost interest in that boring old subject of agriculture. Because it's much easier to sit back, much easier for our governments to sit back and collect rent from Chevron or Shell or whoever. And it's also much easier for some of that rent to go astray. And you understand what I mean by that. You take Nigeria, for example. Nigeria used to be a great exporter of food. Then they found some oil and forgot about agriculture. Today, they are one of the largest importer of food in the continent. And what happened? Of course, most of the oil money is stolen. I mean, I don't want to go into that, but you know all what happened there. And then the oil prices collapsed. That put the country really in a very challenging situation now. We lost the agriculture, and there's no money anymore coming from the oil. Where will we go? Because we failed to use the revenues from our minerals or our oil to really to develop the mainstay of our economy. That will gonna be there for us forever. That is vital. People don't eat oil, people eat food. They cannot live without food. And so this is an unfortunate situation. We really lost focus in that. And what happened some 14 years ago, African leaders, African heads of state, they woke up one morning in Mobutu, beautiful town, and I think they felt sorry maybe for some of those, for their subjects living in the rural areas, and decided, okay, we're gonna allocate 7% of our budgets to those poor guys in the rural sector. Those poor guys actually are the majority of our people. We're gonna allocate 7% of our budget to those people. Today, 14 years later, 80% of our leaders, 80% of our 54 countries have not delivered on their promises yet. So we say to our leaders, do you guys want us to take you seriously? You commit yourself 14 years ago and you did not deliver till now. This is the majority of your people. What are you doing with your budget? And this, unfortunately, is the situation we're facing in Africa. It's an issue of better governance better responsibility from our leaders. To give you an example, last year, the EU, European Union budget for what you call, they call the Common Agricultural Policy, the CAP, was $65.6 billion. That's 40% of the European Union budget, supporting 3.5% of the European population, 3.5% of the European population involved in agriculture. In Africa, we have data on the biggest and richest 28 countries only. The other guys don't have data, and maybe there's not much there. All those guys, they spend $6.5 billion, much less than 5% of their income on agriculture. This is a huge ratio. Our farmers equate 100% of the European Union population, 500 million people. And that is the amount of minute money we're allocating there compared with what the African Union are spending here. Give you an idea about the situation. It's a very underfunded sector, hugely underfunded sector. Maybe the Europeans also are overfunding there, but I leave that to our friends in Europe to take issue with their governments. We have one tractor in Africa for every 320 farmers. To catch up with the norm around us, we need an additional 3.5 million tractors. That gives you an idea about the technological gap we have with other people. So, that is just a quick view, honest and frank view of the situation in Africa. So, what our governments really need to do? I think number one, we need to focus on agriculture. Because number one, we need to be able to feed our people. You check our demography. I mean, we're going to have 1.2 billion more people in Africa. Now we're 1 billion. We're going to have 1.2 billion people in the next 35 years, additional to this. If we cannot feed ourselves now, what we're going to do is 2.2 billion people by the year 2050. This is a catastrophe. And we have the means, we have the resources, we have the land, we have the water, we can deal with it. But we're not focused on that. So we really need to ensure that our governments focus on that. That's our demands from our governments. And it's not just about food security. Agriculture also can be a source of wealth. If you look at the top 20 economies in the world, the top 20 economies in the world, 9 of those economies actually are among the 10 nations which have the greatest agricultural output. It's a fact. So, agriculture can be a good business, can be a road really to prosperity and wealth for our people. We really need to emphasize that. So that's one item we need to do, focus. Focus on agriculture. Number two, let us tackle the issue of the land tenure. We have a very strange situation in Africa. In sub-Saharan Africa, for example, women produce 80% of our food. Actually, agriculture in Africa is done by women. It's not done by men. I mean, this is a fact, and I'm ashamed as a man to admit it. But women are doing agriculture, not men. So they produce 80% of the food. They have less than 2% of the land. We say, why? Why people who farm the lands for generation after generation after generation, they don't have title for the lands? How can those guys be included in the formal economy? How can they monetize what they have? How can they deal with banks? How can they borrow money to buy seeds or to do whatever they want to do? How do you move into commercial farming from subsistence farming? Why the governments are sitting on the title, on non-title? Is it just to feel powerful enough to feel? I don't know. It is one of the very extremely unhelpful situation we have. We need to empower our farmers. We need to give them title to the land. It is their lands. That is very important. And what is sad, actually, is we have seen this recent phenomena in Africa, which we come to call it land grab. Some of our leaders are signing, mostly in secret, actually, very strange contracts and deals with foreign companies, allocating huge parcels of lands to these companies without any due process, without any regulation, without any accountability. And all these agreements are opaque, secret. We don't know why. I suspect I know why, but I think it is appropriate to ask them, why are you doing this? Why are you kicking the farmers, small farmers from the land and giving these big tracts of land, which most of the time is unexploited anyway? So this land grab issue is a serious issue for us in Africa. Third item we need to deal with after land tenure is the water management and irrigation. We need an investment and to pay attention to the issue of water. This is a scarce resource and gonna be more scarce as we go down the road. We need to pay attention to that. I give you an example. You take the River Congo. The Congo Basin, shared by 11 countries. And the Congo River discharges 40, let me read it here to make sure of the number. It is 40,000 cubic meters of water every second in the Atlantic. 40,000 cubic meters every second in the Atlantic. It's a good example. Watch the dialogue of the deaf between Egypt and Ethiopia about the Nile and river dams, etc. We really need to have more collaboration and understanding between our countries in how to manage our water resources. It is very scarce and very important resource to work on. Number four is regional economic integration, which is really essential for us to be able to move goods around our borders. That's something we need to actually, we're doing something there, but the RECs, that's regional economic communities, need to work faster in doing it. Governments need to work faster in ratifying it. And also the RECs need to ensure they are converging, because that can be an issue for the future. Infrastructure, we need infrastructure. Africa needs about $80 to $90 billion every year for infrastructure, essential. We need roads, ports, we need silos, we need electricity. I mean, power generation is a big problem for us. And half of this money actually are available. Internal finances of the budgets of the African, you know, African countries are able to fund half of this, and the other half is not really a major problem through various forms of financing, public, private partnerships, you know, development assistance, other issues there. But the business sector now has started also to pay attention to infrastructure in Africa for one simple reason. The return on infrastructure investment in Africa is much higher than the return of infrastructure elsewhere. You can get easily 15% return on your money in infrastructure in Africa, and that is very attractive to pension funds and for insurance companies, etc. Worldwide, we need to have a stream of income. It's a very viable, really, process happening there. Education and employment is something also very important. I was addressing the Commonwealth conference, you know, the chancellors of the universities in the Commonwealth, and was having a conversation with them. And I was really stunned when I found that 2% of our university graduates are studying agriculture. 2%. 27% of our young people are studying humanities, arts, and literature. And I asked our honorable professors, are we going to build our roads, our bridges, power station, reciting Shakespeare and Molière, or how are we going to build this continent, guys? Be serious. This is public money. 2% of spending on, 2% of the students studying agriculture. What nonsense? Education needs to be for employment. That is very important, because employment is our major issue for our young people. We need to understand that. And that is a major threat for Africa as more and more young people. The president mentioned a number of 10 million people coming, 10 million young people coming to the workforce every year. Where the jobs will come from for those guys? No jobs for guys, no home. What will happen? Those guys go and join Boko Haram or jump in a boat to come to Europe, and it's all the drama here in Europe about people coming in boats or they die in the war. It's terrible. The alternative is terrible. We need to really take care of our young people. We need to create opportunity for them. And agriculture offers a great prospect of employment. We need to pay attention to that. And education, we need to focus education on our needs and employment needs. I don't believe in education for fun. Education for fun, you go and pay for it. Education supported by the state for employment, for producing people useful in our society. That is very important. Last point here of what we need to do then as governments in Africa is a question of improving business environment. By improving business environment, it's important because we need to get investment in Africa. I don't mean at all what actually is happening in many of our countries, which is tax concessions, tax holidays. That's stupid. It's worse. I mean, we're losing money doing that. And nobody comes to invest because you're giving them tax holiday. No. People invest in a place where there is a rule of law, where is decent governance, where there is no bribery, where there is transparency. I am an investor. I'm a businessman. When I want to go to a country, I don't ask if they give me a tax concession or not. No. What I ask is, there is a rule of law. Can I build a healthy business in that country? That's what people are looking for. So stop this harmful exercise of tax concessions and all that nonsense. Focus on governance, rule of law, and environment. And not only rule of law, it is corruption, it is red tape, transparency, all these things, what are business people looking for? It is good governance. That's what business is for. Now, this brings me to the last point of my speech, which is, what about business? So since we're talking about business now, let me very briefly say, look, business really is a force for good. And business create jobs, create prosperity, create innovation, brought us innovation. Everything around us is done by business. It's very important part of our life. It's the mainstay of our life. And as such, business should be always a force for good. But just like our politicians and our governments and our institutions, Business also need good governance. Without good governance, we can end up really with some very bad apples and bad situation. And that's something business really also need to focus on. I see I have little time. I know the moderator looking angrily at me. And you're not angry, okay. I belong to a group of people, business people. They call themselves the B team, letter B. And B, because we believe the A plan did not work. So we're coming with the B plan. And these are serious business people. Those are not do-gooders. Those are really business people as successful as they come. Chairman of, you know, CEO of Unilever, of Salesforce, of Virgin, or, you know, Tata, Ratan Tata, you know, there is from all over the world. We have this organization which is called the B Team. What we say here, we say, listen, we really need in our balance sheet to be very clear about what's our objective. First objective we have is profit. Because without profit, there is no business. Because you go bankrupt, there is no business. Profit. But next to profit, we have people. Next to people, we have planet. That what any smart business man or woman should have really right in front of them as a center to the strategy, because that is the only way to sustain the long interest of the business, to sustain the business itself. Let me tell you why. Take people. Who are people? People are our employees. What kind of employees you want? I want smart, well-educated, skilled, healthy employees. Of course. What I'm going to do with some stupid bunch of people, ignorant guys, I cannot run a business. So we need that kind of people there. Customers. I need customers. But I also need customers who are well off so they can afford to buy my products. What I do with hungry customers who, you know, cannot afford my products, it doesn't work. So I need that. I need the well, you know, the good relation, the goodwill of the community where I work. That's essential for business. So that's people. If they are not my employees, they are my customers or they're part of my community. If I don't pay attention to that, will I have a sustainable business in the long term? No. So we need to pay attention to that. Then you take the planet and the environment. If we destroy our environment, we have no business. We need to understand that. It's in our long-term interest. So business actual interest really is in full alignment with both the SDG and the net zero, the environment objectives. This is what smart people, smart business people should focus in and should do. Now, besides that, business as usual is not viable. You take some simple things. Have you heard about anonymous companies? Did you hear about this class of companies where beneficial ownership is hidden? No, there is a class of company, legal class of companies, where nobody knows who is the beneficial owner of that company. It's run by trustees, some lawyers, and some. You don't have to be in IFAD either. They can be in London, actually. Can be anywhere. And we asked the question, we went to the G20, this group of business people, and we asked our leaders in the G20, can somebody tell us what is the business or the social function of anonymous companies. Can anybody tell us? We in business don't need it. We cannot have an anonymous company in our balance sheet. So why we have it? Who needs anonymous companies? I tell you who needs an anonymous company. If you are a drug dealer, you need an anonymous company. If you are a corrupt leader, you need an anonymous company. Or if you are a corrupt businessman or businesswoman. So are we encouraging criminality as world leaders or what? So we went to engage with, and fortunately, the G20 in Australia accepted the argument and they said, okay, let us work and we'll use these 10 principles to get rid of anonymous company. Till now, it did not happen. Actually, there are 15 of the 20 countries actually have very weak legislation. We are working with some of these countries to really improve this legislation. But at least we're moving forward. So when the business fight for this, it's very important because we are not going as activists or as do-gooders or as crazy guys. No, we're saying we're developing a rational argument for these leaders. So we raised the issue of taxation, mispricing, price shifting, base erosion, all this stuff we need to deal with. Unfortunately, a lot of that really needs proper regulation. The problem is companies and business gone global, but our taxation system are still in silos with no communication among each other. Not that, but also we are fighting, you know, there is a race for the bottom. If Ireland can do that, UK can try to undermine them, this country can try. Guys, stop that. Let us do something about OECD. I was talking with the OECD recently and Greer. They produced, anyway, some blueprints, and this is an issue also we need to move in. So business leaders are involved in all these issues. Each big company member of the B team need to produce to us a regular report, not only about what they're doing in their business, whether the human rights of workers, whether their footprint, carbon, or use of renewable power, anonymous company, not only in these companies, but, and that's very important, in the supply chains. Because that is how we really leverage all this power of business by working also through the supply chain to work for it. So business is thriving, and we are growing, and I hope we'll help win this battle. Thank you very much for your patience, and I wish you a good conference. Thank you.